she probably thought I was doing, yeah, terribly. And it's funny because when you put it that way, it's obvious that there's no way a man who's a skee-ball champion at a small bar in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, could be doing poorly. Those things just don't compete. They don't add up. You have to be doing so well in life in order to be able to claim that title. You're killing it now. We're back in business, mama!
Back in business like we never left. So yeah, you got a date at 4, you said?
I think 4 or 4:30. I'm meeting this British girl in the park.
Ooh, a British girl?
Yeah, you know, it's funny, actually. I have had two romances lately that are both British girls. And before that, never one. So maybe I have a new type without realizing it.
You're now a fish and chips type of guy. It just happened.
Yeah. There's beans on my toes.
are you apping it?
Yeah, this one was Hinge. And then the other one was actually
interesting.
Yeah. Very, very interesting, isn't it?
She's, I can bleep that too, if you don't want that out there.
Yeah, that's between you and me, but yeah.
Nice. One team, one dream. To make Sammy Boy blow his jeans.
Yeah, one team, one cream, baby. Come on. Yeah.
So, what were you doing yesterday? That game you were playing looked nuts. What?
Oh, dude, okay. That's Buoy. So, my buddy Eric, who owns the Skeeball Bar, in which obviously I play in the Skeeball League, he is developing a new game, or has been developing a new game called Buoy, which is like cornhole meets Skeeball. And we are actually going to be playing it on ESPN, the Ocho, this summer.
Wait, what? That's a real channel?
Yes. Yeah, so apparently once a summer, ESPN2 runs a ESPN the Ocho segment where they, you know, broadcast niche things such as, I guess, maybe actually dodgeball, but besides that, stuff like Buoy. So,
oh my God, that's awesome.
Me and some other skee-ball friends who have also taken up Buoy, we're going to be in a Buoy tournament. And yesterday was part of our boot camp. so that we get really good, and that way when we're on TV, we don't look like a bunch of jabronis.
You have Buoy boot camp. What is that? Is that every day a week?
No, well, you know what? Honestly, if it were up to Eric, it would be. But no, this is like, it's like a 3.5 or like, yeah, like 3.5 hour thing every, like 2 or 3 times a week.
Wow. So wait, so it's cornhole meets skee ball. So you're tossing, like, is the ball as hard as the typical skee ball and you have to land it?
No, God bless, no. No, they're called slugs, canonically, because
Sammy Boy's tossing the slug.
Oh, I'm hucking slugs, dude. And you know, Eric can probably tell you more about exactly why, but everything in the game is, you know, because it's called Buoy, everything has kind of a nautical theme, and slugs are kind of like a wet little sea thing.
Of course,
sea,
yes.
Slug. And the balls are kind of sluggish, too. They're like juggling balls, and so they have like a slight squishiness, and they kind of smack onto the board and either roll or stay there, and
they hit with a splash and a sound.
Yeah, pretty much. And so you teams of two teams of two.
Okay.
And
so that's, alternate, that's cornhole-esque.
Yep. And you alternate hucking slugs, and the scoring at the end is like cornhole as well. It's like a net thing, like, if you know, like the scores cancel out essentially. If I get one in the hole and the other team gets one in the hole, it's a wash.
If you hold the slug.
If you hold the slug in the dinghy.
No, I said.
Yeah, there's a bell. There's a bell in it. So when the slug goes in, it rings. And And then there's like a four quadrant, like life preserver, you know, buoy shape around the hole. And in each of those quadrants, it's like a little indented so the ball can stick in there. And that's worth 1 point each. And so okay. there's a few different, you know, a few different scoring scenarios and all that. But yeah. And
now, is there a golden slug type scenario a la golden snitch?
If you get all four slugs in like one in each quadrant of the buoy, it's called a big buoy, and you win automatically.
Oh, okay. So there is a literal golden slug.
Yes, there is. If you get all four, if you get one slug in each quadrant,
you get
of the
a big buoy. Interesting. Okay.
And the other team fails to break it up. Like they have if depending on the order you're going in, they can rebut. And like try to like knock your slugs out, but if you know if they fail to do so, the big buoy stands and you win.
So what is the like? Can you just play this in a backyard? Do you have to be friends with Eric? Like, how do you?
You currently have to be friends with Eric, pretty much, unless Damn. You go to Narragansett. There's one at Narragansett. And
like wait, Narragansett, like the brewing company in Rhode Island?
Yeah. Eric is a consummate game maker and businessman. He recognizes the theme of the game is very nautical, so sure. he's you know, done outreach to a bunch of brands,
yeah.
And Narragansett's picked up a copy of the or like one of the boards. In theory, you know, the rollout plan, the go-to-market strategy, if you will, is to get it in bars as, you know, as widespread as possible. So that way it becomes kind of like, you know, like a classic bar game. But you could also buy one if you want, I think, starting in like August. And they're not going to be that cheap. I mean, I think it's going to be like a few $100 for a board.
That was kind of that was my next question was like, what's the price point to get into Buoy?
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking that they want to make it as affordable as possible. Sure.
But also still maintaining quality.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, that whole part of it, I don't know exactly.
You can't have a dry slug.
Yeah, no, you can't. Well, you're right. Right. If your slug is all, like, you know, crackly and dried up and arid, no, it's not going to do it for you. So, I think eventually... I mean, I think they're going to release two versions. One is going to be like really more like heavy duty, like for a bar and therefore more expensive. And then one might be built of like a lower weight, like more affordable material. And that could be for like the home.
Dude,
home
this
use.
Sounds, I think this sounds cool. So he just kind of, this dude, Eric, just kind of like makes up games and that's his entrepreneurial lane, if you will.
Yeah. He also he came up with Spinagog, which is like a competitive dreidel game. And so there was a Major League Dreidel that existed for a little bit.
No way.
And I didn't know him at the time. This was years ago, so I don't really know exactly what came of that. But I have played Spinagog, and it's very fun. It's like Beyblades essentially. Now Buoy is this big new thing, and I think it's picking up more steam than some of his past adventures.
I gotta imagine the name of it, just based on the two I've heard, Buoy lands better than Spinagog.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I will say, like, the way that I've seen all of the aspects of Buoy come together in terms of like the wordplay for like all the elements, like not just the balls, but also like, you know, like the names of the different components of the board.
Right.
And there's like, there's the deep, there's the Coast Guard, which is like a backboard you can move in front of the deep. And there's all this stuff that really works. It just kind of, it seems like it just, it has a lot of synergy, all the parts. And Buoy definitely, it has a good name to it.
Yeah, I mean, again, Spinagog sounds like a racially charged version of cow tipping.
Yeah, it definitely does. You know, as a Jewish man myself, I felt
hey, Sam, do you want to come play Spinagogue? Yeah, am I going to get spun? What's going on?
Yeah, right. Are you putting me in, like, a gladiator-esque battle against, like, an anti-Semite? Or is this, what is this? But no, it's really just a good bar game. And then, you know, yeah, I mean, obviously, skee-ball has been a big thing, but... I don't know if I don't know all the details of this, but there's some trademark issues over the name for Skeeball, and so it hasn't been able to be something that he's been able to pursue quite as entrepreneurially. So Buoy is his it's his second chance, if you will, after Skeeball.
Dude, it's so cool that you've found a skee-ball league and like have turned this into more than a hop. Like the way that you've dedicated yourself to skee-ball and getting better is so much, it's like Jordan-esque. It's so much like athletes.
Well, it's funny because Jess Stewart is actually the one who brought me into the league. She invited me one day, and I thought very little of the idea because, well, not very little. I thought it would be fun. I didn't think it was going to be like, I thought it was going to be goofy, and it was, and it is still. But she jokes now that she's like, she feels like Dr. Frankenstein, and like I'm her monster because she was like, yeah, come join. And I like joined, and I wasn't that good. And then like, I was like, you know what? Like, holy shit, I got to become the best at this for some reason. And now, like, I'm obviously, like, pretty damn good and pretty passionate about it. And, she feels partially to blame. But it's okay, you know, I won the Brooklyn championship, so.
No way. Wait, hold on, Sam. You, with your obsessive tendencies, got your hooks into something and needed to be the best at it? I'm so surprised.
Can you imagine? I found my little special interest and got fixated and dedicated insane amounts of time and... I want to say money, but obviously I don't spend the money really on the skee ball. I spend it more on the beers I'm drinking while I'm playing the skee ball.
Well, yeah, I mean, you need the arm oil. You got to loosen up that swing.
Yeah, your daddy needs his juice, and so it comes with the territory. I know some people who roll sober and they're able to do that, but that's just not my style.
Roll sober, I love that.
I mean, you know, more power to him. There's an argument to be made that maybe, you know, a few less beers here and there would be better for my gut. But
also, you can be like Pete Weber. I mean, he was that amazing bowler who was knocked off of his ass for like 9 championships or whatever. He doesn't remember all of them or something.
Hate him or love him, you watched, baby.
Unbelievable quote. One of the best.
Who do you think you are? I am.
Who do you think you are? I am.
That's how I feel sometimes when I'm on the skee-ball lanes.
Dude, I think I've told you this story, but I don't think I've said it for the pod yet. And Jess Stewart is such a lovely human being, as is her now husband, but...
No, soon-to-be husband.
Oh, not, they're not married yet? Oh.
September.
Well, either way, they're still both incredible. But Jess is the one person I've met up with off of any of the dating apps. Tinder, like, all of them, we matched on Tinder, and it started as a joke. And then kind of was like, we're both home from whatever. Let's just, who cares? So it was a lot of fun, whatever. That's not the point of the story. The point is then on another break, I a year-ish or so later, I texted her and was like, hey, I'm just curious, like, you know, if you wanted to meet up and hang out again. I had a great time last time. And she just responded with, yeah, I'm dating Johnny Shankman. And I was like, oh, fuck no, that's right.
Hey, thanks for reaching out. I'm in a committed relationship, so I would appreciate it if you would shut your goddamn mouth.
I'm in a committed relationship with someone who is like tertiary your friend and a very good guy also. I texted him. I was like, I'm so sorry. I texted Jess. I texted both of them. It was like, I texted both of them separately and then a group text of like, my fucking bad, I'm so sorry. And apparently now it's just something that they laugh about.
Yeah, honest mistake. I mean, there wasn't really a way for you to know, but I think you handled it with grace.
Yeah, but I always think back of that, of like, you know, whenever you hear of like, just, you know, take the shot. What's the worst that can happen? All they can say is no. And like, I've preached that so many times on this pod, but then also there is the layer of like, oh yeah, you did forget that person is dating your friend.
Dude, I had a thing. It's not exactly the same, but like, I was, so obviously I was in a relationship kind of recently. And during that time, I got a text from like someone I didn't have saved in my contacts. And she was like, hey, and I was like, hey, who is this? And she was like, oh, it's me. We went on that date that, like, you know, a while ago. She actually ghosted me years ago. So but then she's hitting me up again, but I'm in a relationship at the time. So I was like, oh, hey, like, didn't have your number saved. I don't know if that is offensive to you or not. B, I, you know, not available. So then, obviously now, it's come like sometime last year, I'm out of my relationship. We break up. And so then a little while later, I text this girl and she didn't respond to me.
Oh, so, no.
I thought that her texting me when she had texted me the first time after years, I thought, I was like, all right, you know what? Like, not available now, but, you know, maybe now that I am available, or, you know, I wasn't available then, but now that I am available, this could work. Nope. So we're doing this back and forth now over the course of years where we're just going to keep texting each other and forgetting who each other are is whatever. And then not being available. And then as soon as we are, like, nope, don't want to talk to you anymore. And it just bums me out.
Dude, and then one day, though, you're going to meet at the skee-ball bar and she's going to be rolling so well. And you'll be like, man, who is this babe who has such an awesome stroke? She's hitting all hundreds. Like, this is insane. And then you're going to talk and you'll be like, oh, my God, this is that person. It's going to be a great skee-ball themed movie.
I was in the skee ball bar, and for reference, it's called Full Circle Bar. So when I say full circle, that's what I'm referring to. But I was in Full Circle, and I was sitting at the bar one day on like a really quiet Monday night, just like looking like a real proper alcoholic, just sitting there with the regulars, like head down,
waiting for your preferred lane.
Yeah, no, I wasn't even there to roll. You know, I was just there to just put back some Jenny Cream ales, my exes shows up with her now girlfriend, which was really, really surprising to me because she moved across the country to California at some point. So she doesn't live in New York anymore. And so of all the skee-ball joints in New York City, of which there must be at least two, she strolls into mine. But the worst part was, and also, like, first of all, our breakup was like arguably not that great. It was kind of like she probably doesn't want to see me kind of thing, and sure. I didn't really want to see her.
Yeah.
And but she walked in, and because I'm like head down looking like a drunk, she doesn't notice me at first, so she's able to make it in and like order a drink and kind of like establish herself, get far enough in that like it would be weird for her to walk out once she noticed me.
Yeah.
So I kind of like, I'm hiding my face, I'm looking the other way, and the layout of the bar is such that like the front of it is like just bar, and the back is where the skee ball, like the back room is where the skee ball is. So she goes to the back, and then I tell the bartender who I'm friends with, I'm like, yo, it's my ex, she lives in freaking California now, like I haven't seen her in a while, she probably does not want to see me, all this stuff. And then so like every time she comes up to the front to get a drink, I like turn away and I'm hiding and everything, and it was the most awkward thing. But all I could think about the whole time was I was so annoyed, because what's the point in your ex showing up at the skee-ball bar if you can't show off that you're one of the best skee-ball players in Brooklyn? And because I was like, damn it, dude, like I'm so good at this game and I want to go back there and just absolutely show off, but I have to avoid interaction. So then she ends up leaving, and I'm like, I had this whole thing, and I didn't even get to prove how sick I am at this niche skee ball or this niche arcade bar game.
Oh,
and I was so pissed.
God, dude, that's so, in her mind, she just sees this hunched over, like old Obi-Wan Kenobi looking motherfucker.
Yep.
Drunk, yep. In a Brooklyn bar. Meanwhile, you can pull the robe off and be like, actually, I'm still a young Jedi.
Yes, exactly. And you know what? I don't know for sure that she didn't notice me. If she stayed for a good while, and I have a feeling if she did notice me, she would have left probably at her earliest convenience. Oh, but I don't know. Fuck. Maybe not. I could be wrong. I could be making assumptions there. But either way, yeah. Like I think I just looked like a degenerate. Oh, I guess I am. I am a degenerate. I guess I looked just like myself, dude, but without any identifying features.
Dude, now I'm picturing her. She noticed you and like didn't want to have the whole thing and was like, "Man, Sam's not doing well." And meanwhile, in your brain, you're like, "You're like, I'm doing so well. I want to show off to her. This is my kingdom."
Exactly. She probably thought I was doing, yeah, terribly. And it's funny because when you put it that way, it's obvious that there's no way a man who's a skee-ball champion at a small bar in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, could be doing poorly. Those things just don't compete. They don't add up. You have to be doing so well in life in order to be able to claim that title.
Oh, my God, Sam. Okay. That's the best. That's so fun. Can you just, even if I cut this part, can you just tell me the story again? I just want to hear it from the horse's mouth because it's one of my all-time favorite stories.
Yeah, well, yeah, so, yeah, okay. So, all right, so I'm back from college, right, and, years ago, obviously, I'm an old man now, but, it was winter break and I'm back in my small little hometown and get on Tinder and match with a girl who I've known for years. And obviously now we're both adults and we're both on the dating app. So it's like, oh, hey, like context is a little different than when we talked when we were like in high school or whatever. Like now we're both, yep, both kind of feeling this out. So I was like, all right, well, maybe come over. My dad's out of town. And so she comes over. And at some point, I learn that she has a partner. I don't even know how to. Yeah, his name, I guess, is pronounced
Steve.
Probably wouldn't want that out there. But then again, I don't know if she wants me telling the story anyway.
I'm gonna bleep the name. It's the best. That final sentence, regardless of the name, is so funny.
Yeah. God bless. So she and I are hanging, and again, you know, it's like we've known each other as friends for years. So it's like, okay, like when does this get a little spicy? And then eventually, right, yeah, it did, and it's getting spicy. I mean, first of all, just immaculate dome. I mean, fuck me. And so that's like, you know, we're doing that, and then we go into my room, my like childhood bedroom, like twin bed creaking around, fucking shit mattress. And we're having sex, and she gets this call. Oh, so also important to mention, I know she has this partner, but I also know that they're open. So like I knew I wasn't
being, right,
like,
yeah, you were not being a scumbag in this situation.
Yes, that was important. I forgot to mention that. Important to mention that I knew that this was well within, this was allowed. This was within the confines of, or you know, the rules of their relationship.
Everybody was cool with what was going on.
Yes, everyone, there was full consent from all parties. And he actually knew that she was at my place at the time as well, because they'd been texting. So all good. But for some reason, he calls her on the phone, and while we're having sex, and I'm like, oh, that's kind of weird, but also kind of funny. But then what was ultimately really weird and funny was that she picks up the goddamn phone, and she goes, I'm sorry, I can't talk right now. I'm receiving treatment. And the treatment was Dr. Sam, just, you know, slang and dong. But I just was so taken aback by the fact that she referred to our sex act as her receiving treatment. And so I was like, And then eventually I'm like, is this, right after I was like, is everything okay? Oh. And she was like, no, it's like fine. I was like, maybe we should stop. And then, so we do stop and then we like sit around for a bit and she's like, hey, I'm really sorry. I'm like, I'm really sorry. And then we're both like, okay, we're both really sorry. I'll see you later. I'm going to go. Then she left and then that was it.
The treatment concluded.
You know, the treatment concluded without any sort of, let's say it was
it just fizzled out. There was no...
It concluded without fluided, if you will. I don't really know the best way to put it, but it was a dry finish.
Dude, just oh my God, receiving treatment is the strangest way. I mean, you
I'm a clinician.
Yeah, dude, she's just going to you for the medicine.
Yeah, I'm a shaman. I don't know. It's like, I guess actually, you know what? Honestly, parallel idea would be like John Redcorn from King of the Hill treating Nancy Gribble for her migraines, and in reality, they're just having an affair the whole time. So, like, maybe this was some roundabout King of the Hill reference, but I'm not sure.
Oh my fucking God, dude! Thank you. All right, so let's shift into business now because that's what I desperately texted you about. You did the logos for the pod, and I'm starting up this show that I told you about, this weekly stand-up show, and I keep it in the family. That's always been my philosophy of work and whatnot, so I wanted to come back to the man who helped us get the pod off the ground and get the stand-up show off the ground.
Hell yeah, brother.
So we tossed around a couple. Which did you think was the best of the? We're settling on spaghetti logo. We're gonna use that in some way doing stand up. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's the. I think personifying the spaghetti, it gets the people going.
It's a fun. I mean, and plus if there's just all this crossover between the pod and the show, because the show's only gonna be people who have done the pod, so.
Now what you're doing there is you're building a brand. Goddamn it,
dude! Dinner at your place is me, and I am dinner at your place. That's what the goal is. We're trying to just make it synonymous.
Yeah, and then hopefully one day you can have a sick subreddit
where everyone actually hates me, even though there's a ton of subscribers, and it's like, why do you listen if you hate me?
Yeah, then people post weird like AI porn of you and stuff.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that part.
Yeah, I know. I was gonna say maybe I'm just like being a little optimistic there, but
well, I was gonna say also with all the lewds that I post and like boudoir shoots that I've done with Candace, that like there's not gonna be there's plenty of source material to work with for AI.
Oh yeah, massive amount of source material. What those nips are looking like.
So, are you thinking just the plate on the stool doing stand-up, or do you want to do a body?
Well, so, like, all right, so, you know, I was thinking about this, and I feel like the plate on the visual of a crowd of people going ape shit for a plate on a stool up against the mic is funnier to me. I think the thing with the body, I think I was saying this to you over text, is like, it's definitely possible to nail the body, but like, you don't want it to feel like gross or creepy.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, that's so a great point.
So it's like, do you do a spaghetti body? I don't know. I don't know if you do a spaghetti body, because spaghetti body, you don't want it to be like flying spaghetti monster, yeah. You know, Pastafarian church or whatever that shit is. And then it's also like, if you give it clothes, is it like a suit? Is it like a grungy, like shitty ratted t-shirt? Like what kind of, cause you know, obviously, comics have all these different styles. You're right. Are you like the sad, depressed basement comic, or are you like the cool?
I said this recently. I want to be a suit comic so badly one day. That's such a dream of mine, is to justify wearing nice suits on stages and not at like crappy bar shows.
Yeah, exactly. So, well, first of all, you should just start doing that and look like a real douchebag, and then maybe you'll manifest it for yourself.
That's a good point.
Second of all, I don't think spaghetti suit. I don't think a suit. This spaghetti man in a suit works for me. I think there is a good irony in that. There's juxtaposition. You know, you wouldn't expect necessarily spaghetti man to be wearing a suit, but. Yeah. I agree.
Now that you're talking about the body and all that, I'm picturing spaghetti slender man. So you're totally right about it being creepy, weird, all that.
Yeah, and I think no matter what, like, the first perception people are going to have of it is going to be like, oh, that's kind of weird. And
right, but we want it to be, like, fun, cute, weird, not, like, creepy weird. Like, oh, it's weird that a plate of spaghetti is doing stand-up, but that's fun.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a poster. So, it's supposed to be silly and weird.
So I'm thinking, like, you know, a shot from the crowd, maybe looking at a stage, spotlight on the spaghetti on the stool, and then, you know, foreground, we get, like, over-the-shoulder shots of people. Now, I was thinking kind of maybe a Renaissance-esque composition here where we have, like, the spaghetti is centered, and then we kind of have, like, the body's like framing it almost in like a vignette around the spaghetti. And then that way we have a nice focal point of the image. We have room on top, like, you know, above the spaghetti for typography and on the bottom as well, you know, wherever the text needs to be. I know that's kind of what I'm thinking right now.
That sounds fun. That sounds awesome, man. I mean, and also if we just do, you know, it just like the name of the show, which I'll text all this to you for, you know, easy access, but it doesn't have to be too busy because then I'll just add weekly the names of the people who are doing it. Basically, it just probably has to say the name, the location, and the time, you know?
Yeah. And I'll do the art as one thing and then, like, you know, like a Photoshop template or something with, like, for the text and all that, that can be easily editable on top of it.
Damn. That sounds like a show. If I saw that poster, it sounds like I'd want to go to that show.
You'd probably want to go to that show, right? I see a lot of stand-up flyers and stuff on Instagram and stuff from various people. And sometimes, you know, sometimes I'm like, that doesn't look so funny. Too much going on here. Too messy. Not designed by a real artiste.
Not designed by a man who, you know, works for a Fortune 500 company.
Oh, I'm sorry, Danny. It's actually Fortune 100.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah. Just want to throw out that it actually, in terms of revenue, completely demolishes Coca-Cola. Thanks to Frito-Lay, really. I mean, I'm not going to say it's all a beverage game. We all know the soda wars and all that. I'm not going to try to sit here and tell you Pepsi sells more cola than Coke. But in terms of revenue, I mean, really, it's not even a competition.
Oh, man.
So just wanted to put that out there.
How long have you been there now? It's been, what, 2 years?
It was 2 years in March. So
congratulations, man.
Two and change. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I love it. Having a blast. Doing some really cool stuff right now, which I will tell you about offline.
Yeah.
Just everyone go out and buy some Mountain Dew, you know?
I want to pick your brain before we, I'll cut this in a second and we can talk normal, but you posted something the other day that I thought was really cool. And if you could just touch on it for a moment, you've been posting a ton of the old tech deck handboarding fingerboard videos that you used to make in, I mean, what was that, eighth grade?
Yeah, like seventh and eighth grade.
I mean, and that's when we started hanging out, probably. You know, I was ninth or tenth, and you were seventh or eighth. So you posted. You know, this is now, I started doing this little hobby, it's silly, with tech decks and handboards and whatnot, and, you know, making videos from it. Now this is my job, though. I use this program that I used as a kid. Like, this is all the stuff that I worked on as a kid that I'm now doing in my daily life. And you were like, so support the weird hobbies that kids have and do, and who knows where it'll go. So I was, it just kind of was a cool thing to see. Cause like, yeah, man, I mean, tech decks and like handboards and all that, like, I remember, you know, it wasn't like the coolest thing to do back then, but you were
no, definitely not.
So you were kind of like, you know, not like necessarily against the grain, but it was an easy target on your back, I guess. And now I get, you know, look at what you've accomplished and grown to. So it, I guess just that journey, if you could respond in your Samuel way, would, I think, be important to people who find this and might be in a weird spot with a hobby that they think is, you know, an easy target that they have on their back.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah. So like, obviously, having like fingerboard, like showdowns in the cafeteria between like different crews who are like, no, like we're better. I sponsored like this person on my team because they could do a little kickflip with their fingers. Like, obviously it's a little wacky, but we had a lot of fun with it. I mean, I gotta say Aiden Cohen obviously was and is still one of my best friends, and we were doing it together. And I was like super into making movies, making videos. Like, I loved, as much as I loved doing all of these like hobbies, I liked, you know, recording them and making little edits and stuff too. And yeah, I got to this point where I just was like, I wanted to do more cool stuff with the videos that I just couldn't do in like iMovie or right. whatever. So I started looking into other stuff, and I ended up like pirating After Effects, which I just, yeah, because I didn't have the money for it, and my parents, I didn't want to pay for it really. But
this is a pirate supported podcast. We very much enjoy, I pirated so many things, I support it. Steal all the shit.
Hell yeah, I pay for it now. Well, technically PepsiCo pays for it now on my behalf, but you know, it all comes out in the wash, right? So I was doing that, and like, yeah, I was learning just random little things. I just had fun with oh, okay, like cool, I just filmed this kid doing a trick. Like, I, one of the things I wanted to learn how to do was ramp slow-mo, which was like, instead of like hard cutting from regular speed to slow-mo, it like the speed gradually yeah. slows down and then comes back. And it's a thing they did in a lot of skate videos back then, and it was or still do. I mean, it's a thing that's been done a while, but I couldn't do it in iMovie, so I wanted to learn it in After Effects. And then I started messing around with like 3D layers and making rotating clips on different axes and all this stuff. And none of it, I don't think any of it necessarily looked all that great or like came out that amazing, but all, like, it's really funny because now like all of those skills and techniques and stuff in some capacity I use pretty much daily. And I still work in After Effects now as like one of my main programs that I use. But you know, it's really funny because I have people ask me, like, because I was able to get started in this career pretty young without like necessarily focusing on it in school so much, on those things in school at least. And so people have asked me like, wow, like, how do you know After Effects so well? I'm like, I've been doing it since I was making fingerboard videos in seventh grade. Like, I just, I did like little weekly updates for my fingerboard company at the time, and I made myself a green screen, and I shot against the green screen, and I learned how to like light for that and remove the background and all that. So like random little things that are super valuable skills to me now that came out of something that definitely at the time seemed pretty silly and inconsequential. But yeah, to your point, like, I think, like, I don't know, if I ever have kids, which I, you know, maybe one day hope to, then if I, you know, whatever they're doing, as long as they're liking it, as long as they're having fun with it, and it's not like hurting them or anyone, or maybe they can hurt themselves a little bit, but but like, as long as it's not like, yeah, hurting someone else, I guess. Yeah, I mean, fuck yeah, all the way. You literally have no idea what, like, my dad even, like, to this day, like, still, like, pulls out random tricks and shit from random stupid stuff he did when he was, like, a teenager, and he's 70 now. So, like, it's like, yeah, I don't know.
Acquiring it all over time, and hopefully, you know, you find a path that you can use it on. Dude, I think it's so cool that, and you just, like, skipped over this sentence, but you pirated After Effects when you were in like eighth or ninth grade or whatever, and now PepsiCo pays for it on your behalf.
Yeah, it's kind of funny when, I guess, when you put it that way.
How, like, I mean, dude, how that's awesome, man. Like, congratulations from, like, as a friend to friend, as, like, artist to artist, creative to creative, whatever you want to call it. That's like a rap bar. That's like an adjacent rap bar.
Yeah, yeah, I guess if I had any semblance of
pirated
flow,
the programs I when I was younger, now they pay for it for me. Like, dude, that's you worked your way up into something that, you know, was, again, like you said, a little weird and out there, but now you're doing it daily for a job, and that's fucking cool. And I've always said this, you, Troy, Theo, Max, like the boys are like some of the funniest people I've ever met in my life, especially you, Sam. So if I was like a tenth of as funny as you are, I think I'd be an incredibly household famous comedian right now. So,
oh, shut up, dude. You are funny. You're funnier than I am.
Thank you for being just a great friend. And I'm excited for just more of what we have to come as friends, dude.
I'm so excited too, brother.
I'm gonna hit record and we can be normal friends now. Check out Sam Wolfson though. Follow Dinner at Your Place, guys. Love you lots. Goodbye.